Hello guys, welcome to our meetup for today. Thanks for coming on a weekend, that too in the rains. It's raining out there. So yeah, today the agenda for meetup is about what are good bots, what are their behaviors, some do's and don'ts, is too much NLP, is good for bot or not, and we'll discuss some how you should design and develop a good bot, and what are these messaging platforms user perspective of a bot. So yeah, please welcome our CEO Beerud Sheth for taking up this meetup for you guys. Right, over to you, Beerud.
Thank you, and I hope everybody can hear me. Is this okay? Clear enough? Okay. We're trying something different. You know, we have people dialing in from Bangalore and Delhi as well. So anyway, good to see everyone here. I'm visiting from the Bay Area, and I'm here for this week, and it's, you know, really tight schedule, so that's why we said it's kind of hard to travel to different places, so we said we'll just do it via video, right? You know, before we get started, I think let me make sure I get a sense of, you know, what the knowledge level is in terms of bots with the audience. So how many of you guys have heard of bots, know what bots are? Yeah, okay, most of you. How many of you have are working on or building a bot? Anyone? Okay, a few of you. All right, want to build a bot? Okay. Why are the rest of you here? Yeah, no, just kidding. Want to know more? Okay. So, I think there's a lot of buzz, a lot of excitement, maybe you could argue even a lot of hype around bots and so on, right? So, there's different levels of knowledge. So what I'm going to do is I'm just going to start with some of the basics as to what's going on, why is it happening, you know, why so much craziness and buzz about it. And if you actually read news stories, there are thousands of news stories out there. It's impossible to escape, you know, stories about bots, chatbots, and so on. And, you know, it almost sounds like it's the next big thing in the tech industry. And why is it, you know, what is it? So let me start with that, right? And I think according to me, what's going on is that we are on the verge of a major paradigm shift, okay? And you know, that's a big word, paradigm shift, right? But so I don't use it casually, I don't use it lightly. Let me explain why and what it means and why you should care, right? To put it in context, if you think, you know, you should, if you look at the history, the entire history of the consumer tech industry, over the last 40, 50 years, every decade or so, there has been a major new paradigm, okay? And by paradigm, I mean the way we use a computer, right? So in the mid 80s, soon after the birth of the PC, you know, we came up with the sort of the desktop metaphor, right? Every computer came with a desktop operating system, and you buy that, and then you download different desktop clients to customize the experience. Right, and there was a great. That's the way the OS, the desktop OS, was the platform, and the desktop clients like Word, Excel, PowerPoint, these were the applications that you downloaded. And in fact, you may not remember, but at that time there were a lot of CD-ROM games. You know, you could get the encyclopedia on a you know, as a downloadable software. Even games, video games, and so on would be available as downloadable software. Banking or taxes and so on would be desktop software and so on, right? But then about a decade later, the whole thing changed, right? What happened? The web, right? So because of connectivity, because internet got faster and so on, you could now, instead of having a standalone computer, you connected it to the internet. So a whole new paradigm, right? The primary way of using the computer changed, right? The browser was the new platform, and using the browser, you go visit different websites, right? So now you'd go to a banking website, a news website, a sports website, you know, and so on and so forth, right? So it's not like the old thing died, but essentially most of those use cases now move to the web because it was just better, right? And we may still use it, but it's just a handful of desktop clients that we use these days, but most of it is then on the web, right? And there were many other benefits also, right? When we went from client side to server side, the cost of development is so much lower, right? If you've done that, developing desktop clients, developing screens, you know, downloading it, upgrading it, which means new downloads all over again, all of that is very, very hard, but on the server side, It's easier to develop. You don't have to render screens. You're just publishing HTML. Upgrades are easier. Cycles are shorter. All that good stuff, right? So that worked very well. And then a decade later, it switched again, right? So if in the mid-90s we went to the web, in the mid-zeros, we went to, you know, mobile, right? The smartphone OS became the new platform, iOS or Android, right? And you downloaded apps from the App Store, which was the way to customize these experiences, right? So over time, more and more of these experiences shifted from the web to mobile. And it's not like the web has died, but, you know, if in the PC era you had maybe 200 million computer users, in the web era it went to nearly a billion to 2 billion web users, to smartphones was like 3 to 5 billion mobile users. I mean, 3 to 5 billion computer users, right? Big shift. And again, a lot of these use cases migrated to OS, to smartphones and apps. And that brings us a decade later, again, to yet another shift, right? What's happening is, and the new shift, in this new shift, you're going to have the messaging app becomes the new platform, okay? It's like the new browser or the new desktop operating system. I mean, that's the new platform. And you use the messaging app, maybe Facebook Messenger, or hopefully soon WhatsApp as well, but WeChat, Line, Kakao, any of these messaging apps, you use those to then connect to software programs and services. So you could do banking and news and sports and content and all those other things that you do, that you used to do on the browser or used to do on the smartphone OS. Now you can do it inside the messaging app, right? Which means today, if you think about messaging, you just think about chatting with friends, but tomorrow you'll be able to chat with software, right? And these software programs that can send and receive chat messages, that's what we call a bot, okay? So just to demystify it, it's nothing, you know, it's nothing fancy really. It's just a software program that can send and receive chat messages. If it could send and receive HTML pages, we call it a website, right? If it is downloadable on Windows or Mac, you call it a desktop client. If it's downloadable on iOS or Android, you call it an app. And then if you can chat with it through a messaging app, it's a bot, okay? And so you might say, well, why is this happening? I'm happy with my smartphone, I'm happy with apps, we all use it and so on. Well, the problem is people are not using it as much as you think. There are millions of apps, but most of us use just a dozen or so every day, okay? See, people are, there's a lot of app fatigue, right? I may go to Shopper Stop, but I don't have that app. I may fly on Jet Airways, but I don't have that app. I mean, I interact with, you know, I go to the local restaurant, I don't have their app. Because each of those, I mean, that's, for an app, it's a very high bar, right? The only apps people seem to be using are just sort of the top 10 use cases, right? And the number one by far is messaging, right? In fact, it accounts for nearly 50, 60, 70% of smartphone usage, even more than voice calling. So, so firstly, messaging apps are the most popular. So it begs the question saying, look, if people are already in there, why don't we just take the whole internet and squeeze it into that messaging app, right? Then people don't have to go outside and have to do everything. It just becomes so much easier and convenient. So that's one motivation, right? The other aspect is, you know, from a developer standpoint, it's so much better, right? You're going suddenly from client-side development to server-side development, just like we did in the mid-90s, right? So no more rendering of screens. It's just sending and receiving chat messages. Instant upgrades, right? Because there's no downloads. Big deal, right? People don't have to download it. So now if the local restaurant says, hey, here you can chat with my bot to order food, you'd do that. But if they said, hey, download my app to order food, I mean, they're like, come on, I'm not just, you know, just going to use it once. I'm not going to do that, right? Think about how you use websites versus apps. With website, you find some random website on Google, you'll click through, check, and come back. You'll never do that with an app. You're not going to download a random app and bring it. The entry barrier is so high with downloadable clients and downloadable apps, right? But with bots and webs, just like websites, it's so much lower. So this is going to be a huge godsend for the long tail use cases, right? The less frequently used services. I mean, even like, believe it or not, banks, right? I mean, we all care about our money, we all care about our services, but we work with many of these banks and they say less than 10-20% of the users download their app. You know, they still go to the branch, they log on to the website and so on. But there's just, just the download barrier is just such a huge thing. So that's a big deal, right? But once that changes, it's sort of, you know, it's a huge shift. It's a huge paradigm shift, right? You understand? And each of these previous shifts, by the way, right, have created, I don't know, maybe like $1 trillion worth of economic value, right? Think about it. Amazon, eBay, Google, Yahoo did not exist before the web, shift to the web. And Snapchat, Instagram, WeChat, WhatsApp did not exist until we shifted to smartphones and apps. And who knows, right? This shift also has the potential to create multiple megacorns, I mean, huge companies with lots and lots of value, because it's just really transformative. So it's a really big deal, right? It is the next big thing in the tech industry. It just happens, you know, it happens only about once every decade or so, right? So very, very powerful. Yeah. So exactly, right? Well, one second. I think here's the slide. So who's going to build bots and how many apps? He's like, are there going to be lots of them or not, right? Well, it's like asking how many websites do we have, right? Lots, billions. I think that literally every website, every app, every business, every brand, maybe even every person, right, will have a bot. You want to schedule a meeting with me, your bot will talk to my bot and schedule a time, for example, right? You want to shop for something, you're not going to go looking around at websites. You tell your shopping bot to go talk to the merchant bots to find the best deal to say, okay, here's what you should buy, right? So why not, right? All of this is possible. You have, once you can reach users in simple and engaging ways, suddenly more and more brands are going to come here. In fact, they already are, and it's just going to tip over. You know, the first 100, the first 1,000 brands, once that happens, it just explodes, okay? And again, to put it in context, by the way, in India, okay, we've never seen something like this, right? Think about it, in the mid-90s or in the mid-zeros, India had neither a mature tech ecosystem nor a large consumer ecosystem, right? And therefore, whatever, something happened in the valley, and a few months or a few years later, everybody here used it because, oh, they invented it in the valley and that's how it happens. But here and now, right, we have a fairly reasonably large tech ecosystem, enough startups and so on, people who get it, investors and such. And even more important, we have 300 million mobile subscribers. So this is here now, okay? And you may not have been there, but I was in the valley in the mid-90s, or even if you look at the mid-zeros, when you look at the first website, it looks really primitive, really simple. And you're like, what am I going to do with a website? What, you know, what can you use it for? You know, maybe I'll put my brochure, put it up on the website, and so on. And you know, transactions and live sockets and interactive services, and a billion websites later, I mean, it's changed the world, right? Same thing happened with apps and such. So that's what's going to happen with bots, right? Now, because it's just all the forces are aligning, right? Consumers are already using messaging apps in a huge way. The messaging APIs have opened up. Brands want to reach consumers. It's an easy and simple way to do it. They're already there. So from there, it's easier to just chat with Domino's and order pizza than to go open a browser or open an app, place an order, and do something else, right? So the answer is yes, you may have, I don't know, millions of bots, not inconceivable.
I'm sorry.
Yeah.
So I'm not, what I'm trying to visualize is for banking, for hotel, for travel, will there be separate applications where I will interact?
Yes.
There will be one single thing where you're able to, you know, connect to all merchants also.
So, yes, yes, and yes. Okay. What I mean by that, can you get, just ask for the iPhone dongle. I can do a demo as well. I'll show you some examples, right? But think of it this way. Yeah, it's hard because it's new, but look, with hindsight and what you know about the web, think about the web, right? So there were a lot of questions about, you know, are there going to be a million websites or are you going to have like just the top five websites, right? The answer was both. Yeah, there are top five portals. Yahoo at that time, AOL was huge. Okay, Netscape also had a portal, and so on. That was the starting point. But over time, if I am, you know, then search engines came about, which flattened it. So now I could find some obscure website that I didn't even know, right? So you have to solve the search and discovery problem. If there are a billion bots, how am I going to find them? Okay, so that's a search problem, but it will get solved. How do you, you know, how do you quickly use it? I don't want to download it. Well, here you don't have to download, just like a website. So if I'm looking at, let's say, some obscure manuscript, I can find it on the web. Well, you may have a bot that also tells you, you know, sort of whatever, shlokas or, you know, from the Vedas. I mean, yeah. So the answer is, it's going to be all of the above. There are guys like Amazon's Alexa, Google, Facebook, you know, that want to own the entry point, right? Which means, yeah, if you're using the Android phone and you're using an Amazon Echo, you know, you will use that as the starting point. But if I'm sitting in this restaurant, Peshawari in Hub Mall, okay, and it says, it has a little icon which says, okay, you just scan it or you just search for it and you can order the menu. I'm not going to go to Amazon or to Google to then go to Peshawari to do that. It may not even be integrated, right? Because the entry barrier is so small, you may just do it. And by the way, there's a lot of interesting things happening. I'll get into it. But you may have that bot which first lets you order the food, and then maybe can allow you to control the jukebox, and then can tell you what movie is playing next door so you can buy the tickets, and maybe, you know, order a cab as well. And it's not like it built all of that, but you can have, I'm getting ahead of myself, but this, I'll talk about it a little bit, but you can, some of the more advanced things are sort of bot-to-bot communication as well. So the answer is, you know, you're going to have, I mean, see, this is why it's exciting. This is why, you know, we have to figure it out. And I think if you've been in the tech industry at all, these are the kind of times that make it exciting and worth it, right? Because we get to invent it all. So we have some sense, but nobody knows, right? And we have to, right? So as they say, the best way to predict the future is to invent it, right? So that's what we're doing. And in fact, because there are some questions, let me just show you a few bots. Let's see if it connects and shows up. Okay. What's that? Yeah, can we get the light on the set?
They won't be able to see you.
That's okay, but they can see the screen, right? Is the screen shared on the other side?
Yeah.
Oh, it's on Zoom and it's not connected. Okay, I'll just do a shorter version of it. Actually, I can do it on the laptop itself then. Is there a browser connected?
Laptop.
Yeah, so do it.
Yeah.
Browser pick over. Yeah, so I'll just bring up some demos that you could see. It'll give you an idea of what kind of bots are possible and so on, right? But yeah, I think it'll be every brand, every business, everyone's going to be doing these things, which is just incredible potential, right? So the other aspect, by the way, is, yeah, bot interfaces, because it's chat-based, it's a conversational interface, right? Now compare this to earlier interfaces, right? With desktop clients or the web or the app, these used to be very structured interfaces versus conversational, which is a highly unstructured interface, right? So it's, in a way, if the old paradigms, you know, forced people to behave like computers, the new framework is going to force computers to behave like humans, right? Because bots have to understand what you're asking, right? You could say, you know, you could ask for it in different things. I want a large pizza with pepperoni or veggie topping. I mean, you're not going to go, okay, page number 4, tab number 2, button number 7, and then something happens, and you again go to the next page and click on button number 3, right? All that goes away. You just say, okay. In fact, even better, the simplest way of ordering pizza should be the usual, right? And it knows who you are, what you like, what you ordered the last time or the last 100 times. It knows what to order. It knows your wallet. It knows your address. There's nothing else. It should just say, okay, half an hour. That's all you need, right? So think about the usability of something like that. It's just kind of incredibly powerful, right? So, okay. So is that? Okay. So I'll just show you a few quick examples, right? So now this is of what bots look like, how they work, and later on we'll even talk about how to create them, okay? But now this is Telegram. It looks much better on the phone, but I'm putting it on the computer so everyone can see, and it's projected out there as well. So this is Telegram, and in this, you know, normally each bot would have a separate conversation thread, right? And you can chat with each of them separately. But for convenience or for demo purposes, right, we've actually created something we call a proxy bot. And the proxy bot allows us to connect to multiple different bots from the same place. So it's just easier that way, right? So I'm just going to say, you know, all I have to say is, let's say, proxy e-com, right? And it connects to the e-commerce bot, okay? So the way this works is, it says, okay, right? So there you go. One of the first and the most important thing is a bot should introduce itself, right? It should say what it does, what capabilities it provides, and how it works. It says, okay, you know, I'm the Amazon bot. I can do these kind of things. So let's say, you know, I want a book about, I don't know, Gandhi, right? And I don't know why it doesn't pop up by itself. Okay. So it says, okay, here's the first book I could find. I could say, how much does it cost? And it says, you know, it costs $10. And let's say if I wanted to buy it, I could just type it like this. And, you know, it, for now it gives a URL. This is a link to the Amazon checkout page. But later on it could, you know, once the wallet and so on is integrated, it could even say, okay, it'll arrive tomorrow, right? Or let's say, you know, I'm just going to switch to another bot. Let's say if we are hungry, you know, you want to order pizza, so, right, I'm just going to, right, what kind of topping would you like? I'd like to have this, and let's say if I want to buy, I kind of say, you know, something like that, right? It could just happen. Now, this is sort of the first time ordering experience, but the second time it could be the usual, or repeated, you know, kind of thing, right? Now, some of the things, you know, let's say, we are working with NBC to sort of enable, you know, it's a movie bot. You can look up movie recommendations, who acted in what, and things like that. Or for example, if I want to find out new releases, you know, I can just say, okay, which are the movies that are released, and let's say I want to know more about The Jungle Book, right? And then I could say, okay, you know, what's the cast, and right? So you get the idea. I mean, I think all of this is just happening on a conversational interface, right? So you can do these kind of things. Now let's try something more advanced, right? So we are working, for example, with a major bank to enable recharges and top-ups. And then, as you can guess, bill payments and looking up loans and product information and this and that, right? Customer support is a huge use case. You can get, instead of staying on hold, waiting in line, you can get answers very quickly, whether it's refunds, processing. Sometimes, you know, when we talk to these companies, they say, it's cheaper just to give the refund, okay, than to handle the call. Because people will call even for like, you know, 10 rupees, 15 rupees, and it costs like 100 rupees to handle the call. And it just a lot cheaper, you know, so it's cost effective, it's efficient, customer satisfaction, and things like that, okay? One interesting bot I wanted to talk about was, you know, we're working with a company called Sage, which is very interesting. Okay, well, I guess we're testing this one, so it's probably down. So Sage is it's a global accounting software company, if you've heard of it. It's like Tally, but for the world, much bigger. And if you think about it, right, accounting software is such a boring, complicated sort of topic, and also very complex. So they want to make it simple, lightweight, quick and easy to use, engaging, right? So they're building a bot that we're going to launch literally in July, in a couple of weeks, which will, you know, you could just say, I paid, you know, 300 rupees to Cafe Coffee Day for a client meeting, okay? I say that, and then it records it on the back end in the system. It becomes a line item in the ledger. Or I can say I received, you know, 10,000 rupees for web design, right? So if you're a freelancer, a business person, or you can just record transactions, get a running count, invoices, track payments, invoices, all that kind of stuff. So very, very powerful. And on the back end, it still connects to all the same systems, but on the front end, it's very simple, lightweight, kind of conversational interface kind of thing.
So we are naming this bot.
Okay. Yeah, no, I think Sheth services are down, the back end stuff, yeah. So, what else? In fact, I'll just show, right, there's a whole list of bots, and it's sort of hard to... Right, it's hard to demo all of this, but there's quite a few bots that, you know, sample bots that we're creating, but it could be cricket and sports and banking and you know, dictionary. There's a word game, anagram. There's a dating bot, right, which does matchmaking. You can chat anonymously with any some person around the world, things like that. So there's just possibilities are endless, right? To your point, I mean, it's just going to be every website, every use case, and so on. Okay. So I think the other thing, if you read about bots, you'll read a lot about NLP, natural language processing, and about AI, right, artificial intelligence. And one of the common sort of misperceptions is that bots have to be intelligent, okay? And, you know, I think, I mean, if you believe that bots are just the latest reincarnation of a website or an app, then a bot needs to be no more intelligent than a website is, right? We don't talk about intelligent websites. And in spite of that, I mean, it's a huge business, right? So bots don't have to be. They can be, but don't have to be, right? And the point is, it depends on the context, right? What are you trying to do? And sometimes, let's say if it's a pizza ordering bot, you really don't want it to be doing much else apart from understanding maybe 20 or 50 words, right? In fact, the problem is if a bot is too intelligent, so to speak, it can actually raise user expectations and inevitably lead to disappointment. It can create problems later because people will ask. It's like the Siri problem, right? It says, ask me anything. Well, people actually do, and then half the questions it can't answer, right? It's a lot simpler to say, I'm sorry, I don't understand that, but I can order pizza very well, right? It's not unlike when you go to McDonald's or something. I mean, you're really not trying to sort of discuss, you know, Kareena Kapoor's love life or something. You just want combo number two, right? So you don't need a lot of language capabilities. You just need to be able to handle, you know, just enough to get accomplish the task, the objective. And even when you build bots, it's important to sort of guide the conversation in a way where if they ask you an unrelated question, you say, well, I can't help you with that, but I can do this, and so on, right? So you sort of want to nudge the conversation along in a simple way. Then, what else? Let's see. Let's switch back to the presentation. Yeah, I think another thought was, you know, why is all of this happening kind of right now? If you've been tracking the space, you would see that, you know, like about 6 months ago, Slack, Telegram, they all opened up APIs, right? Previously, messaging was just for person-to-person messaging. But once they opened up APIs, you could have businesses, you could have software connecting with people, right? And see, businesses have thousands, millions of customers, and unless it's automated, they cannot scale. If they can't scale, if it's not software driven, it doesn't make sense for a business to be there, right? I mean, your local carpenter may be on WhatsApp, but Domino's can't do that, right? They have to be able to do it in scale. So the big one was sort of Facebook Messenger, announced APIs at their F8 conference in mid-April. And I was there, and it was just a lot of excitement around their announcements as they opened up these APIs, right? So that's what drove a lot of media interest, developer interest, investor interest, and soon, you know, there'll be good bots which will lead to customer interest, consumer interest as well, right? But the other interesting thing is, right, one of the reasons why I'm super optimistic about why bots will be extremely highly adopted is that it's actually, in a way, very invisible technology, right? In many cases, I'm willing to bet that the end user will neither know nor care that there's a bot on the back end, right? Imagine if you chat with Domino's and the pizza arrives. Do you really care whether it's a person or a program on the other side, right? So think about it. You need zero behavior change. You need zero training on the consumer side. In fact, you even need zero awareness for them to use bots, right? It just has to work and work well. And if it does, you'll have lots and lots of people using it. So, you know, this will spread. I mean, it's like, let's say, a customer support line. You're chatting and somebody is responding. And maybe they have limited vocabulary, but they can get the job done. And in a country like India, we know that's fine because, you know, you travel around and not everybody speaks the same language and you still get work done. So the bot's not going to be any different. You just think, oh, he's from a different state than I am, kind of thing, you know. But it's just sort of going to be very, very simple, right? I think, you know, now a little bit about us, right? So if you believe that it's a big shift, you're going to have millions and billions of bots, right? So we've been, what we do, you know, we are a bot building platform, which means it's a tool to help developers build bots, right? It's sort of the easiest and fastest way to build advanced bots across any of these channels, right? And we've been, just some quick background about us, right? We've been working on messaging and bots for many years before they were even called bots, right? And you might wonder how that's possible, except that, you know, bots is not really a new idea. I mean, I think if you go back in the history of the internet, IRC was sort of the earliest messaging channel, right? Internet relay chat. And IRC bots have been around for like since the 70s or 80s, actually, right? It's just that messaging was never a big deal. It was always a small thing. But on smartphones, it's become so dominant, right? It's the only thing people do. That's how people use computers. And therefore, bots has a new resurgence, right? But before, in fact, even before smartphones on feature phones, the only way you could message consumers was through SMS, right? So we are actually India's largest SMS platform, right? So banks, e-commerce companies, airlines, all the credit card confirmations or the banking confirmations that you get on your phone, about half of them come from our servers. So if you think about it, all these messaging-based services, right? I mean, they're simplistic bots. And then about 2 years ago, we in fact even launched a messaging app called Team Chat, which was probably one of the first bot-enabled messaging apps out there. Since all the other messaging apps were closed, meaning they didn't have APIs, we had to create our own because we wanted to enable bots and messaging workflows in IP messaging. So in fact, we used to call them workflows, not even bots. And now that all these other messaging apps have opened up channels, we've sort of exposed APIs around, we've sort of taken all our expertise and experience into building a bot platform. And what does that really mean? I think if you think about what does it take to build a bot, right? There's many different stages. Now, some of these stages are similar to building an app or building a website, but like maybe three or four of these are very unique to bots, right? The first thing is, scripting, right? When you build an app or a website, you create wire flow diagrams and, you know, screen flows and so on. But with the bot, you need a script, right? If the user says this, do that, and if the user says that, do this. I mean, you sort of need to lay out a script in detail. And it's harder than it sounds because it's not just, you can't enumerate all possible combinations because, you know, there's like 20 different ways to say I want pizza, right? So you need to be able to capture all the variations and still be able to detect what they're saying and how they're saying, right? And so on. So I think there's a, scripting is one big part of it. Testing a bot is also very different. Well, test on which channel, do a test on Facebook Messenger or Slack or Telegram or Skype or so on, right? So just making that is challenging. You know, then deploying, where do you host? Where do you host the bot, and how do you make sure it's always on, it can respond to messages and so on. The other big thing is also publishing, right? Publishing means the bot needs to have an identity on Facebook Messenger, on Slack, on Telegram, and so on. So, and then some of the others, you know, once you publish a bot, you need to monitor, you need to track it, analyze it, and so on. So what we've done is, in fact, let me see if I have, So what we've done is we've sort of all the common things that developers need to do. Most, there's a lot of repetitive tasks or common things that everybody needs to do to make a bot successful. We took all of those things and automated it, packaged it, just put it in the platform so that a developer doesn't need to do any of that. It already comes out of the box, right? In fact, the goal we set for ourselves was you should be able to create, you know, to develop, test, deploy, and deploy a bot across a dozen messaging channels in less than a minute, okay? Now, of course, that sounds crazy, but it's, let's say it's a simple bot, a Hello World bot. You should be able to do it very, very quickly. And the point is not that anybody's actually going to launch a one-minute bot, right? But the point is that it gets you started at such a high level that after that, you just need to focus on your business logic, your flow, rather than worrying about integrations and tokens and, you know, hosting and this and that. All of that comes sort of, you know, included, all included in the platform and the package and so on. So, you know, so I think it sort of, it dramatically speeds up the launching of bots, the creation of bots. You can build better bots because you spend more time on enumerating all the use cases and the customer conversations and so on and so forth, right? The other big thing we try to do is sort of embed a lot of best practices in there. There are things that bots should do or should not do, you know, even for NLP and so on, if you want to integrate. There are some NLP tools out there. You know, if you guys have played around with it, bit.ai, api.ai, Lewis, I mean, there's a few of these tools out there that what we've done is we've integrated them into our platform so that, you know, users don't have to put in specific keywords. They can put it in different ways and it would still kind of capture it, yeah, right? Also, there are cross-platform APIs, which means it works on every channel. Once you build it, it just kind of works there and such. And, you know, there's sort of a online tool. In fact, we can just do a quick demo. I think that'd be helpful. Shreyans, you want to? So why don't you just show a quick demo of, can we do it in a minute? I think we're going to time you. Yeah. No, just. Yes. So again, I think the reason why we do this, right, is to just demystify the whole experience, right? It sounds complex, it sounds crazy, and so on, but we'll just show you how to build a bot on our platform, and you'll see how simple it is, right? So maybe I'll just talk, and you can do it. I can describe it. So I think if you go to our website, and you know, it said build bots or get started. If you click on Get Started, it sort of integrates with your GitHub login, so he's just logging in there. And what you'll see is that a lot of these things have been kind of, like I said, they've been pre-packaged, they've been automated. Is your network working?
Yeah, so what language do I need to know to develop on your platform?
So this the bit that we're going to show is going to be in JavaScript, but you can build a bot yourself in any language. You know, see, there are 2-3 different things, right? If you really want full control in your language, on your database, on your hosting server, and so on, you can build it there and just connect to our platform with a callback URL. But if you use our tool in here, why don't we just show you, and I'll come and explain it in a second. Were you able to log in?
Yeah.
So he just clicked, you know, sort of get started, and there are it shows you a few bots you've created. But let's just start by creating our own bot. So we'll just pick. No, it's, well, you log in with GitHub. If you, you know, most developers have GitHub accounts. So yeah, so that was just a one click thing. So you don't have to literally create an account, it just automatically created. And then all you're doing is saying, okay, I'm going to create this bot. You pick a name for it. We'll call it what, MeetupBot10, right? And if he says create bot, Okay. The name is already in use. Okay. So what it does is, just hold on a second here, right? So there's a lot of sample code here, and it sounds, you know, looks more complex than it is. Can you increase the screen size? I think people would, or font size, I think it'll be easier to see. But the most important point is it drops you into the message handler, right? What I mean by that is, look, what's the heart of the bot, right? It really is, if the user says this, if the user says X, reply with Y, right? Really. You don't want to worry about integrations, you know, Facebook Messenger integration, Slack integration, this thing, that thing. You really want to program the bot. So what it does is it drops you into this thing called the message handler, which is where you describe what the bot's going to do, right? And there's a lot of sample code which allows you to do certain things. But why don't we create something where, let's say, so move the rest of the code away, and let's say just if the user says hi, you know, we'll reply with a hello, right? And maybe add the user's name in there as well. Right, so just a couple of lines of code. Now this is JavaScript you were asking earlier, right? So what he's saying is if the user message, if the user says hi, we're gonna say hello followed by the, let's say the user's name as well. And just return from there. Okay, so that's it, okay? Basically a one-line code, if you will. But if you go to the, so let's test it, right? Where's the emulator?
Yeah, the font.
Okay, so looks a little distorted because we increased the font size a lot. But here, right? He said hi to the bot, and the bot sort of replies with the message. I mean, it goes through that code, right? So this is just the emulator, but let's say you want to look at it in your messaging app, right? So let's go ahead and deploy this, right? And with this one button click, what it's doing is it hosts the bot on a server somewhere, and you can now test it in on your phones in any messaging app, right? And we're going to show it on a few screens. So you had Telegram up here already. Now, just one sec. So to make, if you think about it, right, normally when you build a bot through a traditional way, there are very limited mechanisms of testing the bot, right? Because you can't, somebody can't just chat with a bot, and Facebook in particular, you have to approve each person and so on. So to bypass all of these problems, we actually created the proxy bot, which I showed you earlier. I can point the proxy bot to any bot, right? So in this case, we were already chatting with it. So let's go ahead and try chatting with, what is it, meetup bot 10? Right? So this is in Telegram, right? So it says, okay, fine, I'm mapped to this bot, and if I say hi, right, it should respond with the hello, right? So that's it. Now I can do this through Messenger, Twitter, Slack, Skype. I mean, it works. It works in all of them.
And
yeah, so what happens here is this is the channel, the user ID provided by the underlying channel to the bot, right? I mean, the bot has no other way of knowing what it is, right? So in that system, he was logged in as Malay. In this system, you know, it's user ID. So I think there's privacy issues and so on, so you may or may not know that stuff. Yeah?
Was the bot created on Telegram with the name gupshup.io?
No, that was created in gupshup.
Yeah, anyway.
Okay. No, good question. So go back to the platform, and I'll show you what I mean by that. So you know, there's a bunch of different things. Right? Click on publish. So let's say you build this bot, and now you're ready to actually publish it with its own name. Okay? So then it takes you here and says, okay, here are the things. So click on that. It tells you there's a few steps you need to go through to publish it, if that name is available there, and then you pick it, you map the token, and so on. We make it all easy. Automatically. So once you publish it with your own name, then you can use it directly with that name. Okay? But until then, right? So our point was, when you're in this dev test iterate cycle, right? You don't want to have to wait till the publishing. I mean, that's almost the last step. But you're going to cycle through 100 times in the dev mode, you know, dev and QA, before you really get to that. And usually it takes anywhere from, you know, a few minutes to a few days, depending on the approval process, right? But you sort of define all those identities and so on. Now, let's see, could we try something more complicated? Oh, you just registered it on Telegram?
I I can. Should I?
Yeah, why don't we do that?
Yes. So that we need to pass the bar file.
So these are the steps. Like, let's actually try publishing it there as well. Now, Telegram is one that allows you instant publishing. Okay, you can't do this on Messenger, by the way. So, I mean, yeah, bots is just software, right? You can create it. So I'll come back to that where you can map it to our platform. So you create it in your own language, but then you'll have to host it somewhere and still map it to our platform for all the other features that it gets into. And I'll come to that in a quick second. Right. Yeah, this is an official Telegram bot. And that's the official process.
So you will like, you know, production building up what every other vendors are. They also register with the same.
Yeah, or sometimes people even directly build a bot with direct access to Telegram without any bot platform, right? You can always do that. The challenge with that is then you have to have a Facebook Messenger bot and a Telegram bot and a Slack bot and so on, which then, you know, I mean, that's developer nightmare, right? I mean, what we enable is write once, run anywhere. Run to some places.
You're talking to BotFather. BotFather is actually the bot created by Telegram so that it can interact with the bot developers who have asked to publish it out.
Correct.
Right?
Yes.
Right. So, let's say I'm building it on Zapshot, and he's building it on XYZ. And when he's publishing his bot from XYZ,
yes. Yes. Right? So, oh, okay. So you just published it as Meetup Bot 10, and now the same thing works in exactly the same way. Right? And we can add.
Instead of proxy, they use a different keyword, right?
Now it's a direct name. It's official name. Instead of. I mean, it's hard to repeat it, but.
Yeah,
so first
you
talk
to
Godfather
saying you want to create a new
meetup. Now let's say you are a new user,
you want to
interact
with this.
So say, huh?
Meetup
bot
10.
Oh, so just, yeah, you
search
just.
Search for
Meetup
bot 10 on Telegram and just say, go
and
start the chat with
them. Yeah. See, chatting with the bot is no different from chatting with a friend. In that same search box, if you wanted to chat with me, you search for my name. Same thing with the bot, no difference. Okay, now go back to the platform and scroll back. I'll go to the callback URL, right? So develop. So there was a question earlier about creating your own bot in your own language, right? So what we can do is, if you hosted it somewhere else in some other language and such, you can just map the callback URL here, and that again connects to our platform. The benefit of that is, you know, again, you get all the cross-platform APIs. And we're going to show, just click through some of the others like analytics, data, configuration, logs. You want to be able to monitor, right? To monitor and track what the bot's doing. These are all the things that all bot developers need to do again and again. So in this case, what is it? You know, it loads up the logs, for example, right? Different conversations. And go to analytics. Right? Well, there's not much data here right now, but you can also do. Yeah, I think you can configure a lot of things. Now, so far we just built literally a trivial bot, right? It just said hi or hello. I mean, can you do something more? Can you do something more interesting?
Yeah, sure.
So callback URL is, so when a message comes for your bot, our platform needs to know who to call. No, it's not a phone callback. This is a programming callback, API callback, yeah. Just go back to the platform, and let's just use the existing code. Why don't you show the HTTP test thing, for example? No, we can just use the existing one. Okay. So let's say one of the things you might want to do is when the bot gets a message, it needs to go to another website, get the information, come back. Let's say, you know, train schedule, right? So the user says something to the bot. The bot has to go to IRCTC, get the information, come back, and then send the response to the user. So in this case, for example, there's a sample code right here, right, which says, okay, if you do the HTTP test, it goes to that API. Now, can you just click on that URL in the browser and just show, right? So if you look at it, right, that's just a regular, yeah. It takes time, okay. So it's just a regular URL that provides some data. And you know, if you did the same thing through the bot, it would kind of, the bot would ask the web service, get the data back, and respond to the user kind of thing, right? Similarly, there were...
We can test it in the emulator, so this is the data.
Okay.
So we can test it first in the emulator and test it on the Telegram.
So when we do that? So that was already in the sample code, we provide that as an example, but let's say if you try it here, you'll see what happens, right? Right, so it sort of goes to, makes a service call, comes back and provides that data right here. And of course the same thing would work on any messaging channel as well, yeah. Kind of thing. I mean, here everything is a notification, right? Because a bot can send a message to the user, right? Absolutely. But you have to be careful with bots sending alerts to users, okay? Firstly, in Facebook Messenger, a bot cannot even initiate a conversation with the user. The user has to do that with a bot. Second, the user has the ability to block a bot or to, you know, sort of, and Facebook Messenger actually tracks the block rates. And if they become very high, they'll shut down the bot altogether, okay? So you have to be very careful with sending alerts that it doesn't, because, you know, it's a slippery slope into spam, and they don't like it, they don't allow it. So you have to use it very selectively. Right, so sort of the same thing here. Now another thing, you know, there's some other sample code out there. For example, if you want to, let's say, maintain state, right? A bot needs to remember. Like if the user says yes, the bot needs to remember what question it asked, for which the answer now is yes, right? So again, is there some, can you do some quick code, or is there some sample code there?
So we have a direct setting in the database. I can demo that itself.
Or,
yeah, I can.
Yeah, why don't you write up something quickly, something simple? So we'll just do a little test where if you say something to the bot, it'll remember it, and then the second time you ask for it, it would sort of...
Let's just say
add, right? And it'll keep updating the number. I'm sorry? Was there a comment? So, you know, there's multiple ways in which you can sort of, the bot can store data to a local database and, you know, do it, right? We have some advanced calls as well, but there's built-in sort of simple tools. There's a simple DB, if you will, if you're just recording simple variables. So out here, he's just created a variable called count, okay? And right, and it's now we track it at the room level. What I mean is, look, a bot is chatting with different users, right? So the bot may want to maintain the state for each user separately, right? You may be at stage 4, that person may be at stage 7. Obviously, each is different. So in that case here, what he's done is, okay, there's count at the room level, chat room, right? So you have different, because sometimes you may even have groups, multiple users in a group. So in any chat room, if you say add, it'll increment the count and it'll publish it, right? No, so just show the publish the thing as well, yeah. Right? No. In send response.
Okay, sure.
How do you know the count? How do you check the count? Right?
So I don't
count colon and just yeah, just publish that. The other clever thing that we are doing, right, is this bot. When you think about hosting, okay, we are using something called serverless hosting, right? It's not a dedicated server somewhere that's hosting all the bots. It's a service built on top of AWS Lambda, if you're familiar, where it just, the bot essentially is stored there, but it's sleeping. When a message comes, you wake up the bot, it processes the response, replies, and goes back to sleep. And that makes it very, very cost effective in terms of, you know, hosting and storage and efficiency and uptime and all of that, right? As you know, if you're maintaining dedicated servers and hosting, that's a huge problem. So that's the benefit of sort of using the standard platform where all these tools are seamlessly integrated, right? So, okay, are we ready to try?
Yeah.
Okay, so go ahead. You didn't initialize it.
Yes. First. So we'll just initialize it here first. And then we'll...
Is there any bank that's starting to...
If not,
to work?
What's that?
Is there any bank that's starting to implement this about, you know, just mentioned about their customer balance?
Yes. Yes. We're working with multiple banks.
That will be implemented.
Yes.
So the scalability is good. If number of more number of user types is the same bot at a time.
Yeah, I don't think there's a problem.
I think it's common. I don't want to use just one bot, I'll just put one bot.
Yeah, I think that could be. Well, so you have to be careful. If the bank is building a bot, then the bank just cares about their accounts and their users. You're talking about aggregating multiple bank accounts, but that could be a good business, right? You could create your own bot that can then access those things. Now, but it's tricky, right? Banks don't provide access to those APIs to get the bank balance. I mean, that's a very complicated thing. So, but the next best thing is you can at least have 6 bots. Actually, no, let me back up, right? You could, you know, we can enable bot-to-bot communication, right? Now, this is a very advanced thing. I'll come back, just hold that thought for a second. Let me just show this, we were talking about it. Is it ready? Okay. What's that? In Skype? Yeah, pull up Messenger. We'll actually show every channel.
We'll show it on Facebook, it would be easier.
Yeah, just do that. m.me. Yeah, so you can pull it up on different channels, right? But it's all of this is integrated already, so. m.me/gupshup.io. And just pull up Twitter and others as well, right? Yeah, and just pull it up on Twitter then, maybe. Twitter is public, right? So, yeah, so I think in Twitter, again, you have a gupshup proxy bot where you can just try. Oh, I see. Okay. Yeah, so I think you can do it in many interesting ways. You know, one of the other things I was talking about was, let's say when most people talk about, bots, they talk about bot to human communication, right? Like you can order pizza, you can book a taxi, you can shop for something, and so on, right? But I believe what's going to be much, much bigger than even bot to human communication is going to be bot to bot communication, right? And it sounds crazy and far-fetched, but think of this, right? Let's say you have a pizza bot, and I take a translate bot. And if I combine the two, I have pizza bot in 100 languages, right? And that might be just one line of code. And even simpler, right? Two different developers built two different bots, and a third person combined the two to create a whole new service that didn't exist before, right? You could take a shopping bot and a merchant bot, and they could now negotiate prices, deals, find the best offers, and things like that, right? You could have some transactional bot and a currency exchange bot, and now that bot can accept transactions in any currency, right? So the possibilities are endless, right? You can do, it just opens up a whole new crazy world of possibilities. In fact, somebody could actually build a bot that can create other bots by combining bots, right? And crazy as it may sound, we're sort of developing some of the platforms and some of the specifications that enable this, right? To enable two bots to talk, well, firstly, there has to be a channel, right? Because they're not going to make an HTTP call to each other. There has to be a messaging channel. And secondly, they both have to be able to understand each other, so you need some common language and standards and so on, right? So so I think that's going to be the next frontier, right? After, I mean, right now everybody's focused on creating bots, but then very quickly you're going to be able to mix and match and combine bots in interesting ways to do a lot of other stuff. So, are you connected? Are you ready? Yeah, you were asking about right? This is on Facebook Messenger, and do that ad thing as well. You'll get an ad again. Oh no. Okay. Just do it again. Right? So it just sort of remembers state and can update itself and so on, right?
So every time you're writing an ad,
it's a simple demo, yeah. Right? But it's by user. Now, if a different user, or if we did that from some other channel, you'd again start at zero and go from there. Right? Now, in other cases, by the way, you might want to, the bot might want to remember state across all users. Like, say, if it wants to maintain the user count, that doesn't vary across users, right? So, in that case, you track bot level data, as we call it, versus room level data. Right? So, all of these things are possible. What is that?
In the code, we already have that as pseudo-code. This is actually counting the, at the bot level data, it's counting how many users are using it. So when I actually use it from Telegram, not here, but from Proxyworks, so it said you are one. And when I actually use it from Facebook Messenger, it said you are two. So this is something which is at bot level data where you can
initiate same way I did it for the delivery data, and it keeps on adding whenever user tries to add it. So that's what is important. Right? Does that make sense? Okay, let's take some questions. Yeah.
So, let's say this particular idea, in some vertical, I'm trying to build a bot, which is going to provide information. How do I promote this bot? Because it will be used from various messengers. Yes. How do I establish or promote this brand? See, if I have a website, it comes in Google search. People will eventually know the name,
will
directly come to this.
Right.
What happens in this?
So, good question. These are early days. Some of these things are being figured out as we speak. In Facebook, for example, it just shows up in the search box where you put in the name. It kind of brings that up, right? But yeah, you want to promote it, you want to get word of mouth and so on. I think there will be search and discovery is a big problem, and I think lots of people are working on it. For example, we are also working on it to enable a third-party bot store, right? There are bot stores emerging where you can look at top bots and interesting bots and check out new bots to download and things like that. So you will, just like you have app stores, you're going to have bot stores, you're going to, and Facebook is also going to make it discoverable. So that's how it's going to grow. Also remember, these are early days, so you have a lot of first mover advantage, right? If you're just there, you know, today there are press stories saying so-and-so launched a bot, right? But after the 1,000th bot, that's not a story anymore, right? So time is of the essence. I mean, if you can launch something quickly and get out there, I think that can be very, very powerful. Yeah?
Just to stop here, we circulated out this meetup bus, right? You can directly ask a question and your question will be displayed there. You can use that bot to actually send us questions and we'll be reading it out from...
In fact, I guess Kishore asked a question about, template features on Facebook Messenger. Why don't you show that as well? I think, so there are, so what we try to do is while we have cross-platform APIs, different channels have different capabilities. Like on Facebook, you can do, just take from your docs here. In Facebook Messenger, you can have structured messages, right? With a little image and option ABC kind of thing. So the same thing here, right? What we try to do is we have APIs for channel-specific conversations as well, right? So here's a quick example in the documentation, and if you just pick... Well, there's code also down there. Yeah. Let's take this. Right, so... Right, so just format it, right, so we can look at it. Can you just switch off the light for a second? So what we're trying to do here, now Facebook gives you these structured messages, and you'll see it once we sort of, yeah, right, and even formatted, right? If event message equal to vanilla. So what it says is it sort of, what's your favorite flavor of ice cream? There are three options, and if it responds with one of the options, right, it just sort of comes back. So, okay, let's just try it. I think in this case you'll have to deploy it because this would only work on Facebook Messenger. And
it would be better.
Just try it. Now, if you can try it on your own messengers, because this may or may not show up very easily, but you were already logged in, right? Yeah, but this would work if you try, this is what, Meetup 10?
Meetup bot 10,
yeah. Can you do m.me/gupshup.proxy? Hello, right? No, no, because that conversation and that context is still live, right? It's working on the phone, I think it's not... it came in, yeah, so... Right, so just click on vanilla now, right? So it says, okay. right? So creating these kind of scripts are very simple, and a lot of bots just have these simple flows. In fact, one interesting bot you should check out, right? There's a lady in San Francisco, Esther. She created the Esther bot, right? Which is just her own resume, right? So every aspect of her resume is as a bot. So it says, okay, what would you like to know about me, my education, my work experience, or my projects? So you click on education, it says, okay, you know, early school, K-12, college, graduate school. When you click on that, then it shows the next one and the next one, right? So it's just a navigation tree. I mean, here it's sort of a very simple menu, a hierarchical menu of options that it flows through. And you know, this is an important point. While we talk about conversational interfaces, it doesn't always have to mean unstructured or free text, right? It can also be point and click. This is a very powerful way of guiding the user, right? Because sometimes the user may not even know what options you have, right? There's a reason why when you go to a restaurant, you know, they give you a menu. They don't talk to you saying, okay, what would you like to eat? Let's start from first principle. That would take too long. It'd be way too inefficient, right? But you, so that's what this is. It's just a simple menu and you provide choices. It's also easier for the user. They don't have to type it. They just click one of these things and it just works.
So we have an expert.
Yeah. So spellings and so on is actually very easy to handle. Most NLP engines can, you know, can take care of simple spelling, like one character off or something. If it's completely off, I mean, you can, you know, you can train your. So if you use an NLP system, if you guys are familiar, you define the entities, and for each entity, you define synonyms or aliases, right? So you can also use different variations of misspellings to say, okay, these words also mean the same thing. And in fact, you know, you can do it continuously over time, right? So you've defined a bot, and then you look at messages coming in, and if there were unrecognized messages that you do want to recognize, then you just update the bot so that the next time the user sends a similar message, it'll still understand it, right? So a bot can evolve, it can learn, it can get better. And so on. I think, let's say, voice-based bots. I think voice actually is a very orthogonal concept, right? What I mean is, any bot, right? If it's a text-based bot, now most phones these days have a sort of a dictation component in there, which means I can dictate text to the bot, which then converts to text, processes, and when it comes back again, maybe you can convert it back to voice. So, also, Alexa, Google, you know, they have, all of these are voice activated. But ultimately, you know, the core of bots is all going to be text-based because you need to do a lot of processing and so on. So I think it'll, you know, but you can have voice conversion from voice to text and back on both sides to cover that as well. Regarding the context, yeah, predefine a pickup location time and drop variable in my code. So when you say predefine, I'm not sure what you mean. I think we need to, you're just initializing the variables, right? Any variable you kind of just need to initialize. So that's not something. But if you want to, if you mean you're sort of, I don't know what it means really. No, if you're predefining it as in, if you ask the user saying, what's your location, when the user replies, so for example, Facebook Messenger, you can show a, you can throw a button, and when they click that, it sends you the lat long, you know, the exact location. And you use that and update it into the variable, right? Or yeah. Is Anupam here right now? Can he okay, what do you mean?
I mean like app, okay, for storing the content. So if he has shared pickup, I don't ask him pickup, I can ask him the drop position or pickup time.
Yeah.
But for example, in handling feedback, come friend write something randomly. About his last person, some variable.
Right.
But I don't know what is available to show. So, which would be needed in.
No, you're right. So, actually, you're right. Actually, building NLP bots is fairly complex, right? If I generalize what you said, here's the problem, right? You're sort of in one conversation. So you're asking him, let's say pizza, right? What size do you want? What topping do you want? What drink do you want? But in the middle, the user chooses to change the conversation. He'll say, oh, by the way, do you have burgers? Right? and you ask, the bot asks, okay, what topping do you want? And the user says, do you have burgers? I mean, that's not the name of a topping, right? You can't put that in the variable, right? So you have to understand that the context has changed and answer that question, right? So you're going from one context to another, answer that question. And then the user says, oh, by the way, I'll take veggie. Now you have to remember that veggie was a topping from the previous context in the conversation that you're in. Because as humans, when we talk, we context switch all the time, right? You could be checking in at the hotel, and then they say, okay, can I have your credit card? And you say, by the way, do you have a king bed? And you're talking about the king bed, and say, okay, what places can I visit nearby? And then say, oh, here's my credit card. I mean, you're sort of switching context, and you kind of, you know, you have to maintain it in a stack, if you will, so that when the response comes in, and if it's related to one of the earlier contexts. So it gets tricky very, very quickly. I don't think there's a simple answer to what you're asking, but you just have to recognize, is it a valid response or not? And if it's an invalid response for what you asked, then is it related to some other context? Yeah? Do we use our own server? No, I think, like I mentioned, it's a layer built on Amazon Web Services. We use AWS Lambda. So the bots, it's all serverless hosting, it's instantly defined and so on. So highly scalable. Somebody asked about scale and volume of messages. I mean, it just scales very, very quickly and easily. Can the bots be timed? It behaves different on weekdays and so on. Absolutely. I think, in fact, the best thing about this whole bot framework is every conversation is a private conversation, right? Which allows infinite potential for personalization, right? So it's not just about days of the week or location, but it could even be the way the bot talks to you is different from the way the bot talks to me, right? Because it knows, let's say I'm a first-time user versus somebody else who's a more advanced user. Somebody is asked speaking in Hindi, someone else is speaking in English. Somebody has made choice A, B, and C, right? So when I say, okay, the usual pizza versus when you say it, it means different things. Time of day is easy. Of course, the bot can check the time of day and say, okay, on weekends it provides a different question, right? A different answer to the same question. Location as well. With location, you have to ask the user because I think Facebook, the app doesn't automatically show it to you. But if you know the location, then in Mumbai, the answer will be different from Delhi, for example, right? How do you parse the location context sent to the bot? So I think this is, do you have a demo or?
I can demo.
Or just show sample code if you have it.
There are two ways of handling it. We have a predefined location handler as well. Whenever user sends a location, this handler gets called in the bot code. Otherwise, you can directly use the location inside the message handler where we were using the conversation. So either you can define if the message
can you,
type.
Can you put this code in there?
Yeah. Sure.
Just put that. Right? Yeah, we can even just try it right now, I think.
Yeah, so I'll directly use the location handler, put it out in there.
Who's on Facebook Messenger? I think you guys were trying, right? So in a second, just try it.
asking him a question.
What's that? Oh, you're sending it through SMS, okay. Yeah.
Finally, I got this message.
No, but you're replying to testing.
No, I'm not replying.
Yeah.
Replying to this number. Last.
Oh.
And then I got the message.
Okay. Yeah, we'll look into it. But your message should have come. Is there a question there? Just check on Twitter.
Yes, I'll check. But you can see as to here, I sent my location and I passed out the location and sent it back to the user. So that's how you use the location. Twitter. So okay. We are getting new messages. It's down here. But we are going one by one. So if you're sending...
Let's do it faster, I think.
Yeah.
So just scroll up, where were we?
We were here. Sachin says, how different are traditional IVR's workflows from bot scripts?
Yeah, actually, can we replicate the same workflows to start with? So if you're familiar, IVR's used to be this structured sort of decision tree, right? So that's the easiest. And by the way, in Facebook Messenger, you have even structured messages. But even in text, you could say, OK, option 1, 2, 3, which one do you pick? Once they pick option 2, you can go to the next one and so on, OK? And that's a good way to get started, OK? But you can do a lot better with natural language, right? Because why navigate through a tree when I can just say, okay, you know, tell me more about your auto loan or a life insurance product. Why are you going to take me through three levels of hierarchy? So, you know, I think of it, but it's a great way to do incrementally. Start with sort of a decision tree, IVR-like decision tree, and then go forward there.
Next one is from Vimal. What about when you want additional metadata along with the request to the bot? Could you get it with the first call or a background second call transparent to the user?
So, hypothetically, let's say I wanted to build an Uber on some bots. So, Uber, like one of the first things it does is take facial rotation. Can you do something like that? Can you get additional information when the user types in his first query? Like, can I, for example, when I let's say I'm creating a bot that says I need a cab, that takes in a request saying I need a cab. So when the user says I need a cab, I automatically ask for his location and get it without the user having to, you know, additionally specify the location again.
Yeah, but I think, no, so I'm not understanding. It's is it in the Uber app or is it in Facebook Messenger?
Can I create a bot that?
No, because, see, I think for privacy reasons, the underlying messaging channels are not going to share information with you. Okay, they will ask the user to give you the locations. You can't even get the location unless the user gives it to you, right? So, or you can't access the camera, for example, on the device, unless the user uploads a photo themselves. So I think most of these things are currently not possible. So the only context you really have is the message and what's happening inside the messaging channel. I don't think you can do. What's that? No, so there's just user ID. There's no IP address in messaging apps yet. Right? What was it? Are all chats stored for future references like call center, voice records? So, yeah, I think in our logs, I mean, we just store, I mean, the messages are stored by default. I'm sure we have an archival policy, but it just works like that. And I guess you can delete it as well. You can manage those things. So can this raise a privacy issue? Well, I think, you know, if it's your bot and your users are talking to your bot, I mean, you already have access to the data. There's no privacy issue there, right? The privacy issue would be if you can see somebody else's data, which, you know, we don't allow, the channels don't allow it, so on. So I don't think there's any privacy issue. There may be an issue where every bot has to have a privacy policy, right? So if you're building bots, I mean, you have to be careful who can see that data, who do you share with, and so on. I think there are, you know, you don't want to violate those policies because that can cause problems as well, yeah.
The next one is, while deploying a bot on Facebook, the app that we create needs to be reviewed by Facebook. So can Gupshup eliminate the need of reviewing the app in order to make it public? No.
I don't think Facebook is going to like that very much. No, I think the short answer is no.
next one is from Vinay. Is there any option of content upload instead of hardcore coding like a flowchart?
You know, that's a great question. We didn't go into much detail, but we are about to launch templates, okay, to create standard templatized bots. Let's take the example of restaurants, right? I mean, the use cases are very similar. There's a menu, there's order taking, there's hours of operation, address, directions, things like that, right? So we are creating a template, and any restaurant owner can just fill in the template, which automatically creates a bot, okay? Even better, we're going to allow sort of a messaging-based admin interface, which means the restaurant owner can send a message to the bot saying, you know, today's special is black dal, right? And the bot knows if the message comes from the owner, then he's authorized to update the special offer so that when any other user now looks for the deals, it's available, right? So why should anybody have to use the web? They can just easily, it's basically you're configuring the bot through the bot itself, right? Or you're, in some cases, there are web-based templates, but in some cases, it's even messaging-based interfaces. So.
Next one is, can you talk a bit about web.ai?
Sure. So, you know, I think if you haven't used NLP tools, I mean, it's at some point, maybe not the first thing you do, but at some point you should experiment with it as well, right? And do we have an instance we can demo, or I created, you know, maybe on a different laptop? So let me just skip. I think, see, the basic idea of NLP, it sounds very complex, but you know, what you can do with it. So let's say, take a sentence like, you know, I want to eat a green apple, right? I can define certain what's called entities in this statement. So let's say apple, right? I define it as a fruit, right? And then green as color, right? And eat as the intent, right? What I want to do with the colored fruit. Now I can define aliases, right? So I can say fruit is not just apple, but it could be banana, mango, grape, and papaya. Color is blue, green, red, yellow, right? And intent could be eat, slice, give, take, okay? So once I define these entities, right, and the NLP model now can understand things like, you know, I want to take a blue mango, right? And it doesn't make sense in this context, but the point is, you don't have to explicitly tell the 500 different combinations, every permutation and combination, you don't need to define it explicitly. You just define each entity separately, and now it can take many different combinations, right? So if the user even says, you know, do you have a green papaya, right? I mean, the system will automatically figure what the entities are, and then you can do things with it. A more realistic example is, you know, I want to fly from Bombay to Delhi, right, tomorrow, right? So there's the to location, the from location, the date, and the action, right? That the action could now be fly, reserve, cancel, price, okay, availability, right? While location could be any location, time, date, time could be any day, right? So once you define the entities, it can take things like, you know, I want to cancel my flight from Bombay, you know, for next week, right? And it would understand what it's saying. So what an NLP system does is it takes the user query, okay, analyzes it and gives back a structured JSON, right? So it gives you all the entities in a structured way, and then the bot can decide what to do with it, right? So it just sort of query parsing. It parses the query, structures it, and then you can book the flight and then say, okay, confirm, your flight has been confirmed or canceled or whatever it is, right?
Currently, AWS for like GitHub, they're using both or they use manually answering.
Which ones?
Provider,
so it depends on the service provider. I think, you know, I mean, some companies try to do it in a manual way, but that's not scalable, really, right? It has to be automated. It has to be bot-driven kind of thing.
So.
Well, Team Chat is just a messaging app. It's like Facebook Messenger or Slack or WhatsApp. I mean, that's nothing to do with it. The bots are different. Right, there's a question there about write once, run anywhere. suppose you want to send a structured message when the user types a keyword on Facebook, and for the same keyword on Twitter, want to send a different kind of response, would this have to be handled in code by filtering the source of the message, or how would that work? I guess, yeah, I mean, that's the simplest way, right? That logic has to be somewhere. So you would show up the object type, right? Why don't you display that? So you know, we didn't talk in go into much detail there, but when you come to the message handler, the system gives you two objects, right? The context and the event. There's a lot of information in there, right? That you can use to process it.
We have something called channel type here, and the channel. So based on in the JSON response to the bot, so that you can actually pull that out and write code based on what channel the user is accessing the bot on. I can definitely show that.
No, that's okay. I think people get it.
Yeah. So if you want to know what all objects and everything which is actually sent to the bot when a user converts, so you can go through this documentation which we have, and these are all the attributes which are available. So you can use them to, you know, like message object or latitude will give you the location whenever user sends a location, and channel will give you channel type, will give you the channel name, like FB, Telegram, Twitter, Slack.
Okay, I think, you know, I think we are in the interest of time. Let's just, is there a critical question? Can you show a demo of bit.ai? No, I think that'll have to be offline. We'll have to do it later.
And
how would you differ bot with apps like Siri, Cortana? I mean, no, actually, they're almost bots themselves. Can gupshup bots be used to access user data such as user profile, whatever the platforms are willing to share? Well, I think the answer is right there, whatever the platforms are willing to share. So there's nothing gupshup can provide that, anything beyond that kind of thing.
Yeah.
So anyway, I think that's it, right? We're going to be around for some more time. But are there? Okay, so there's food and there's food for thought. So, all right. Thank you so much, everyone, for coming. Hopefully this was useful. I hope there are many more people building bots after today. Yeah. Let's do a quick poll. How many of you are going to build bots now? Okay. There you go. More hands than before. What's that? Already doing it? Okay.